It's time for Howlers and Growlers. A weekly show from our Arizona Coyotes writing pack, bringing you the latest news, rumors, trades, player grades, prospects, and much more. From training camp to the playoffs, from draft day to the trade deadline, our team covers everything ice hockey in the hot desert. So sit back, grab your favorite cold beverage, and get ready for Howlers and Growlers.
Welcome to Howlers and Growlers. I am your host, Pat Brown, and we are thrilled to have you join our show. Joining me, as always, my Coyotes line mate at the Hockey Writers, Haynes Evans. Haynes, how you doing today?
I'm doing well. I hope you are as well.
I am. Sorry I didn't pause in between names today.
You're fine. I looked embarrassed. I'm so embarrassed watching the episode over again now because there was no pause.
Because there was no pause,
I know, and I just look like an idiot. I know.
It was good. It was all good. We had fun with it.
Yeah,
it made
for a good laugh.
And you're a good sport, too. Also joining us, what a treat we have for you today. Capitals and Red Wings beat reporter for the Hockey Writers, as well as our Morning Skate newsletter editor and my good friend, Kyle Knopp. Kyle, thanks for joining us. How you doing?
Oh, I am so excited to be here, Pat. I've been following your show since you guys kicked off a couple months ago now, and I'm so excited to finally be a part of this and went out and made sure to pick up a growler so I could be in spirit and take this in full.
I love it. And that's how we kick things off around here. So what are you drinking? What's in that beautiful growler?
So this is from a nice, small little pub pizza and microbrew pub in the area in the Baltimore area. I'm out in Maryland and I have a Maryland lager right now. So drinking a nice little Maryland lager.
Nice.
And, it's no longer Oktoberfest season, but there's lagers are still in season. And that's kind of my go-to.
Well, you kind of set the stage for me because I'm drinking a local brew as well. Four Peaks Golden Lager. Good stuff. It's good
Love
stuff. And like you said, it's never out of season. I don't care what anybody says. Haynes, bring us home on this one before we start talking some hockey. What are you rocking this week?
I have a seltzer again.
You need to own it.
Beautiful.
Haynes,
no,
you need
no,
to
no,
own
I am,
it. Nobody
I am,
judges.
I am,
this is
I am,
a judgment-free zone.
I'm rocking a mango seltzer. I'm going a little.
Love it.
Yeah, I don't have beer. That's why.
Well, we're gonna have to have a wine episode in the near future.
I'm not a wine person, so that's gonna be. A hard
well, I know, but we. You saw. I mean, you got to give Carter Hutton's wine a try.
Oh, yeah, I've heard about that. Someone I know just bought a case of it recently.
Yeah. So, I mean, we may have to, but I digress. We've already spent too much time on the intro, but what fun we have had! Let's talk some hockey, though, eh? Because we got some big news. I don't know if you guys saw. But the Coyotes won their second game of the year, and it was a thriller over the St. Louis Blues. And it's amazing what happens when you don't give up 5 goals in 5 minutes, isn't it? super exciting stuff comes out of this game. Really quickly recapping, Barrett Hayton had his first ever multi-goal NHL game, scored 2 goals, one of them. One of the more beautiful goals you'll see this year, kind of a display of agility and strength and skill, just awesome individual effort there. And Wedgie, when is that parade? Because Scott Wedgwood standing on his head yet again, 34 saves on 36 shots. And all of a sudden the Coyotes are winning games, or at least singular winning a game. So full disclosure, they've got the Columbus Blue Jackets tomorrow. We're taping on Wednesday night and then the Detroit Red Wings on Saturday. So we'll see what the future holds, but let's revel in this victory for a little bit. So Haynes, we're going to start with you on this one. What do you take away from the win over the Blues?
You know, this was a good team win. You know, I wouldn't say this was a well-rounded team win. St. Louis outplayed us for the most part in terms of shooting. They had a lot of chances, but we called them on a bad night. This was a team who just came off a back-to-back swing against, I want to say, I have it right over here. It was Carolina and Edmonton, and they just came off a back-to-back to them, had a day off, and then came to play Arizona. And this team is now on a 4-game losing streak, so they've been hit very hard recently after a very hot start. But nevertheless, it was a good showing from the Coyotes team that had strong goaltending especially with Wedgwood playing an amazing game. Barrett Hayton had an outstanding performance and really showed his skill, especially in that first goal. And the Wedgwood parade is coming up. I have been in talks with you about getting set up. So I'll get you an official date on that.
Love it. Absolutely love it. And you know, what you mentioned about St. Louis struggling a little bit right now really rings true. And it's kind of funny. Every single game that the Coyotes play, I hear the opposition say it's a trap game. And that's borderline insulting. I'll tell you, even though the Blackhawks won, and shout out to our folks at Blackhawks Banter, we are going to have them on a future show because I lost a bet. We lost a bet, Haynes, even though I'm the one that made
it. Yeah, I know.
So shout out to those at Blackhawks Banter. Can't wait to have you guys on. We'll figure that out for a future show. But I was a little miffed that I saw a couple of Blackhawks folks calling it a trap game. You had three wins. There is no such thing as a trap game when you have three wins. Okay, I'm off my soapbox. Kyle, what did you see from the St. Louis, Arizona game?
The important thing to keep in mind is that all win streaks start with one game. So I think the Coyotes are on their way. So, you know, I mean, we'll
see. Coming in hot, Kyle. You're coming in hot.
No, I mean, I thought they played a really good game. It was more of a desperation game out of the Coyotes than the Blues. And you could kind of see that, especially from the jump. The Coyotes came out and really kind of swarmed the Blues in their end and, you know, like you said already, that one goal by Hutton was Braden Hayton.
Yep.
Thank you. Was really good. I mean, it was a pure power move and such a great thing to see from a young kid that, you know, it's showing that confidence at this level. Yep. And then Wedgwood played phenomenal to finally weather that storm when the Blues decided that it was time to get back into the game and start playing. And yeah, they did outplay the Coyotes, but Wedgwood was there and made the saves he needed to save. And the defense got the job done when they needed to. And I thought the Coyotes did play a good enough game to get it done. And when you only have one win on the season, getting it, playing just well enough to get it done is something that you need to see, because in a lot of these games for the start of the season, the Coyotes just haven't had that luck.
Absolutely.
So to be able to get that type of win, I think, is going to be huge for their confidence moving forward.
Huge for the team. Wedgwood, by the way, still in his New Jersey Devil pads
yes,
and helmet.
Yes,
one of these days, one of these days, maybe he'll unpack and stay for a little bit. Lord knows we would love to have him stay for a little bit.
They make pad wrap these days, which basically you can change the color of your pads within like 20 minutes. Like, come on. Like, I know the rent situation's bad over in Arizona, but like, get this guy some pad wrap.
That's good stuff. But you know, another thing, switching gears a little bit, both of you and myself talk about a good team win. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, truer words were never spoken, because the Tucson Roadrunners might as well have been skating around yesterday, because ladies and gentlemen, the Coyotes are currently dealing with 9 players on injured reserve, either through actual injuries or COVID-19 protocol. And those players are Strawman, Larson, Ladd, Fisher, Yaskins, Schmaltz, Hutton, Timmins, and Zingle. All of those players are not in the lineup right now. And so when I primed our agenda prior to the show and we're thinking, who's going to step up? Well, we may have gotten our answer yesterday with who's going to step up, because Barrett Hayton, high draft pick, high expectations, but not the world. Nobody expects much out of anybody on this team this year, to be honest. And really, when the Coyotes were down and out and needed somebody, anybody to step up, Barrett Hayton shows up and scores 2 goals. So that's my pick. That's who I see. And if you guys agree, so be it. So Kyle, we'll go over to you this time. With so many injuries and so many regulars out of the lineup, who steps up for the Coyotes?
Yeah, so I did like Barrett Hayton's game last night, and to have a Hayton and a Hutton on your team is just going to trip me up this whole show, even though Hutton is out and I know that, but it's just going to trip me up. So, but when you prompted this question to me, I had to admit I had to go back and look through the Tucson Roadrunners lineup and see who they
had.
Can
we please say Tucson, please?
Tucson, sorry.
I'm going to have to correct you on that one, only because because my wife is from Tucson.
Tucson Roadrunners.
There you go.
My fault. told you, this East Coast is going to get me in trouble out here.
Love you, Kyle.
Yeah, we're sorry. Don't have it ready to cheers you. But yes, so Had to go back and look through the Roadrunners lineup, sure. And two names stood out to me. One was Blake Spears. I watched him when he was with the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds. I was with the Saginaw Spirit at that time, and so I got to see him up close and personal. And the kid has a very heavy shot. He's got one of those shots that, you know, he's probably going to end up being a third liner, you know, maybe sneak into the second line at a time, but he's just got one of those shots that when he has a chance to unleash it, it's just a cannon. So to have him, I think he's got an NHL ready shot, and he could be a guy that really steps up and fills a role or a void. And then the other guy that I love and want to see more from is your British beauty, Liam Kirk. I mean, I was hoping he was going to make the opening lineup and stay up with the team this year, but he's been playing down in Tucson. And so I think that I would love to see Kirk get an opportunity at the NHL level this year.
Two fantastic call outs. And Kyle, I am impressed with the Spears call out. That's phenomenal and super cool that you saw him with Sault Ste. Marie, to be honest. Haynes, you got the last word on this topic. Who is going to step up, or has that already happened?
You know, Barrett Hayton was a good call out there. Barrett Hayton is someone that Kai's fans have been kind of dreading him never fully developing like Strome has. But last night showed a sign of a guy who hopefully is taking the right turn and is really going to kind of, you know, amp up and keep going and keep producing at the level he is going right now. But then a guy who really kind of stands out to me, who's kind of been an up and down guy the last few years, and I generally believe could be a big part of the defensive core, depending on how many guys we are out with going forward, is Kyle Capobianco. The kid is very, he's not super, super young, but he's not super old. He's right there kind of in the middle. He's got a great shot from the point. He's smart with the puck. He moves it around. He's led, you know, he's led himself down there in Tucson. And to see him up here, hopefully he kind of gets a real steady shot up here, because I think he's a great player for this team, and I think he could be a great defenseman going forward with what we're dealing with injury-wise right now.
So, first of all, if Dale from Twitter is watching, and I hope you are, Dale, you're going to be very happy that Haynes pronounced his Capobianco's name correctly. So awesome for that. We were kind of laughing about the away announcers yesterday, but Haynes, fantastic. He, by the way, scored the third goal.
Yes, he did.
So that's a great what a great call out. And like we all said, kind of a good gutty team effort. Mm-hmm. You don't always win all the battles, but you win the game. And those are the types of things you need to do when you've only got one win on the year. So
yeah.
Good stuff. It's all been warm, fuzzy to this point. So let's cool the mood a little bit here and talk about a name we've been talking about since before the season even started, and that would be Karel Vemelka, aka Veggie, decidedly not Milkman, to be clear. He's having a rough go at it lately. You know, he has not posted a save percentage above 0.833 since November 5th. His current stats for the season, 3.29 GAA, 0.897 save percentage. So those numbers have dropped dramatically from what we were seeing even a couple of weeks ago. So we're going to start with you, Haynes. Is there any cause for concern? Is Veggie losing his magic?
You know, I wouldn't necessarily go to the extent of saying he's lost his magic. I mean, we still do have to take into account here that this guy is 25 years old. He's spent his whole career, like I've said before, in the Czech Republic. This is his first time playing in a completely different style rink, different league, different skill player level wise. I mean, you see who he's playing in front of most nights. Granted, has he looked bad last few games? He has. The last two times he's started, two goals very early in the game. Mm-hmm. He's looked very shaky. You know, those, I think, are the nerves finally catching up to him. But I think having a guy like Scott Wedgwood's huge.
Oh, yeah.
Just because even if Vemelka has an off night, you know Wedgwood's is going to give you a better night if he comes in the next game compared to, like, say, Carr Hutton.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. And you know, Hutton probably isn't that far away from returning. So there are going to be some interesting decisions because for all intents and purposes, Bill Armstrong and Andre Tourigny have been pretty clear that the Carter Hutton experiment is far from over. So it'll be interesting to see what happens when he gets healthy. But one other thing that I noticed is, you know, teams are getting wise to Vemelka, right? You get more tape on a goalie, and you can find those holes. You can find where he's weakest. And to be frank, I kind of noticed his blocker side seemed pretty weak from the outset. So it seems like teams are exposing that as well. But to your point, Haynes, Not a whole lot in front of him helping out either. And with this type of team, you kind of need a goalie who can perform when there's not a whole lot in front of him helping out. So Kyle, your thoughts on Vemelka, and should Coyotes fans be worried?
No, I don't think they should be worried whatsoever, as long as he's keeping his mind about him. And what I mean by that is Vemelka is in a very interesting situation this season. He's with a very, you know, young team, a rebuilding team, and he's with a team in which the one of the starting goaltenders, the project, as you said, is currently unavailable because of the situation that we have going around the league. And so normally with young goalies, especially goalies that are new to this level, and, you know, Vemelka is another mm-hmm. type of interesting prospect because he's coming from Europe. But when you have a young goalie, they usually have these growing pains in the AHL level. And the reason you have them down there to learn these pains is because, like you said, as teams get more video on a goalie, as teams see the goalie more, they can kind of see where their holes are. They can understand their type of game a little bit more. They can know if you need to shoot first or look for a backdoor deflection, or if you have to get them moving side to side. You know, they understand their tendencies a little bit more. And so when you have a young goalie, and you can look at goalies such as like Carter Hart or Thatcher Demko, who had like really good young rookie seasons and then had a sophomore slump because they were kind of already put into that starter role and didn't have the chance to really go through those growing pains at the AHL level. Yep. With Carter Hutton coming back, I think Vemelka would serve really well going back down to the AHL for a little bit. I think that would really help A, with his confidence, and B, just allowing him to learn the North American game a little bit better, and then, you know, build up those stats a little bit more. But, you know, it's a team in a rebuild. He's a young goalie. He's going to have to get over this hump sooner or later. So as long as he's keeping a positive attitude and going into every game, just trying to compete and just trying to do his best and not letting it weigh him down, I think there's no reason for concern at all.
And, you know, quick shout out to Vegji, because he's been doing it. I just want to see him get a win. I want to see him get an NHL win.
Yeah.
He deserves it. He stood on his head, even though the team didn't win early in the season. He's the reason they had any chance at winning. Hutton came in and he was a disaster. And Vemelka provided a little bit of stability, and he got no goal support whatsoever. I mean, I actually felt bad. So that Seattle game, their first win of the season, right? Seattle scores twice in the first minute, first two goals. Vemelka gets yanked. Wedgwood comes in, stands on his head, and what happened to the team? Scored five goals. You feel kind of bad that's when the goal support comes, when he's not between the pipes. But at the end of the day, he's got to have a short memory, right? He's a goalie, got to have a short memory, and we'll see where it comes. But super, super good perspective by all of you. Let's take a quick time out. Toss us a like, hit subscribe, be sure to comment, and thank you so much for watching our show. Make sure you check out all the other shows on the Hockey Writers Network. We've got Saber Scoop, The Hockey Writers Grind Line, Chicks and Sticks, What's Crackin', Blackhawks Banter. We've got Union Junction, Prospects Corner. The list goes on and on. Make sure you check us out. We're on Spotify and iHeartRadio. We are also on Apple Music. And make sure that you check out our morning newsletter, Morning Skate. Like I said, Kyle is the editor of Morning Skate. And follow him on Twitter while you're at it, at @THW_Knopp. And certainly follow us on Twitter as well, at @HowlersTHW. So our bills are paid. We're still on the air. Life is good. We live to see another week. Let's talk about some upcoming hockey, shall we? Because Kyle, you have covered the Red Wings extensively. You also participate in the Hockey Writers Grind Line with me. So wanted to have you on and get your thoughts. They got the Red Wings. The Coyotes got the Red Wings on Saturday. These are two teams on very different trajectories right now. But before we kind of get into each respective trajectory, our viewers want to know, what should they expect from Detroit this weekend?
I think you're going to expect a very hungry team. So the Red Wings only have two games this week. They're both on a bit of a mini West Coast swing. They have the Vegas Golden Knights on Thursday, and then come to Arizona to face Coyotes on Saturday. So if the Red Wings were to lose in sorry, Vegas, then, you know, you're going to see a really pissed off team that doesn't want to sit around for 5, 6, 7 days dwelling on a couple of losses on a short trip away from home. So you're either going to get a very, very hungry, desperate, angry team, or you're going to get a very hungry team that's still on kind of a upswing from playing against a meddling Vegas team, shall we say, right now. They haven't really been as impressive this year as they had in the last few years. And so we're not really sure, at least I'm not really sure what to make of that Vegas team at this juncture in the season. But I think you're going to see a Red Wings team that's just going to come out ready to play. They're going to put the pressure on. You know, they have a high powered first and second line. Their first line, when they have the control of the game, it very much flows in the way of the Red Wings most times. And by that, I mean, you know, if you look back at the games that the Wings have lost recently, it's when their first line of Larkin, Bertuzzi, and Raymond have been shut down. And when that happens, then the Wings can kind of fall into a playing at their opponent's level type kind of game plan. But
sure.
In terms of if that first line really dictates the flow of play, then you're going to see a Red Wings team that's going to be in your face all night.
And, you know, this is a Red Wings team that has been where the Coyotes are right now.
2-3 years ago.
The Red Wings were almost spared from complete embarrassment, ironically enough, because of COVID.
Yes.
Because the season ended prematurely for them. So fans weren't subjected to an entire season's worth of losing. It was close to the end, but that was probably the bottom for the Wings. And they're a couple of years removed from that now. So they're a team that knows what they're coming in about to face in the Coyotes. So,
yes.
Haynes, interested in your perspective here, looking at the Red Wings. What do you expect to see out of this team on Saturday?
You know, I mean, y'all covering the Red Wings can't say enough high praise, and I can't either. I mean, Lucas Raymond been great this year. Mort Sider has been great this year. That first line of Bertuzzi, Raymond, and Larkin has been great this year. Alex Nedeljkovic.
You gave me goosebumps, Haynes.
Has looked great. Alex Nedeljkovic has looked stellar in the net. That was a huge pickup from them during the offseason from Carolina. And, you know, Detroit's just come out and surprised everybody this year, which is good for Detroit. And, you know, I'm happy for them. You know, this is a team at one point, 25 straight years making the playoffs.
Yeah.
I mean, that was impressive. I mean, you don't make the playoffs 25 straight years being mediocre or decent. You make that being one of the best teams in the league. Mm-hmm. And to watch in the last few years kind of go from high and mighty to all the way down to rock bottom, and now they're slowly turning a page. I mean, this is a team that knows exactly, like you said, knows what the Coyotes are going through. They've been through this. And, you know, I expect them to come in and play a good game. They know the Coyotes are coming in every game playing as hard as they can. They're not coming in here throwing the towel away. So I'm expecting a good game out of the two teams.
Absolutely. And, you know, there's a lot of similarities between what the Red Wings went through and what the Coyotes are currently going through. Granted, I think Bill Armstrong went a little more scorched earth than Ken Holland / Steve Yzerman. But remember that the Red Wings rebuild has spanned two GMs for all intents and purposes. But what I want to remind the Arizona fans out there is the Red Wings also got screwed on draft, right? Mm-hmm. They had the worst record. They ended up picking third. And you know who they got with the third overall pick? Or was it fourth, Kyle? Fourth overall pick. Excuse me. Lucas Raymond.
Yeah.
Who, you know, it's still early in the season, but boy, if he's not the front runner for the Calder right now, I don't know who is.
And to piggyback off of that, I mean, they had the fourth pick and the sixth pick in two years in which they should have had top three picks, at least, if not the number one or number two. And with those picks, they got Raymond and Sider. Yep. So, I mean, sometimes you just got to get lucky through the draft. Sometimes you got to get lucky through the lottery. It kind of depends on where you land. So if Armstrong can draft as well as we like to say Yzerman has been doing for the past couple of years, then yeah, I think the Coyotes are going to be okay no matter where they land. But yeah, absolutely. It's, you got to have some luck no matter where you are.
Yeah. And you know, Coyotes fans are scorned at draft lotteries because it has never favored them. And it's kind of funny, right? The rules were basically changed because of the Red Wings.
Yeah.
Because of how badly they slipped in multiple years in the draft lottery. And now you can't fall, what, more than three spots, right?
Yeah.
So So no matter what happens, Arizona is going to have a solid, solid pick. More on that in a little bit, but we just want Arizona fans to keep the faith because Lucas Raymond was taken fourth overall and just 1 year removed from his first season of professional hockey in the SHL. He's a front runner right now for the Calder. So good stuff. Let's talk a little bit about the rebuild and Detroit's rebuild, Kyle, because I'm not going to lie. This Coyotes rebuild honestly feels a lot more painful than the Red Wings rebuild that we witnessed and that they're still rebuilding, but they're getting over that proverbial hump.
Right.
Regardless of whose is more painful, let's not make it that type of competition. What do fans do in a season like this to stay engaged with the team? And Kyle, you've got some experience with this, having gone through the Wings rebuild the past few years. So I want to start with you. What should fans do to stay engaged with the team during a rebuilding year?
That's a fantastic question, Pat. I mean, you know, it's so frustrating. And as someone that gets competitive because, you know, I've played sports at a decently high level. I've been a competitor throughout my whole life. You know, I don't like to lose. I hate to lose. Even when I coached my 14-year-old girls hockey team out here in Maryland, like, you know, we're not always the best team, but on the ice, but I still hate to lose. So, a lot of that, when you're in those situations, you got to find moral victories or little victories. And the best way I can say that with a rebuilding team is to celebrate your young players. And in the same conversation, celebrate those veterans that are kind of on their way out. With the Red Wings, the big part of the rebuild was dumping some of those really bad contracts. And that's kind of what handcuffed them at the beginning of the rebuild. And so I think a lot of fans, that was their focus on, okay, once we dump those bad contracts, get rid of some of this dead weight, we can move on and be a much better, younger team. Well, the Coyotes aren't quite in that same position. Yeah, they have some older players, some wily veterans, you know, love me a Phil Kessel. He's grown on me over the years, but, you know, love seeing him still out there. And
Iron Man Phil Kessel. Iron Man Phil Kessel. We got to talk about him in a future episode.
Actually. Absolutely. Anyway, yeah. So you celebrate the Phil Kessels. You celebrate the young guys coming up, you know, the Braden Hayton. Did I mess it up? Probably
again. Barrett Hayton.
But you got to celebrate those young guys, you know, find the Liam Kirks on the team that are coming up and like and just get behind them and understand that this is going to be a rough year. We're going to have a lot of rough patches, but let's celebrate these kids that are coming up and are really getting this opportunity and that are going to be the base and the nucleus of this team moving forward. And so you got to find those little things, celebrate the small victories that Armstrong pulls off when he does make a move that benefits the team in the long run. And, you know, you just got to have the regional pride, you know, got to be an Arizona fan and got to stick by your team. And I know that's always tough. And especially when there's a lot of outside factors going on, like there are right now. But yeah, I mean, just celebrate the young kids and, you know, help the veterans sail off into the sunset.
Absolutely. And, you know, we didn't give Haynes enough credit for pronouncing Nedeljkovic's name right on the first.
That's
go.
True.
I
That's true.
To say, I think he's the first person in podcast history. And I'm not talking about any of ours. I'm talking about any podcast in the history of podcasts to pronounce Nedeljkovic correctly on the first go round.
I would say that's probably very accurate.
Haynes. I played a lot of NHL. Thank you. I played a lot of NHL. So I've learned how to pronounce a lot of players' names over the years.
Is that the trick?
The weird one. Well, I mean, Nedeljkovic doesn't sound that hard to pronounce. I don't know. I read it, and the first thing I see when I see it is just Nedeljkovic.
Yeah,
I don't see it as anything else. It's Nedeljkovic. I don't see it as anything else.
And cheers, I think Vemelka helps kind of with that, too, because you got that J in there that kind of throws everything off. The LJ and Nedeljkovic has that, too, the JK. And so, you got to find those patterns and stick with them, right?
Love it. It's like the spelling bee. You know, we need the language of origin.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely love it.
Haynes, a verb or a noun?
Could you please use it in a sentence? Nedeljkovic made a sick save the other day. Okay, anyways, Haynes, your thoughts on what should Coyotes fans be doing right now to stay engaged, to stay in tune with the team? What should they be doing?
You know, first off, checking us out.
Kyle, he's a professional.
Love it.
Kyle said it best here. You know, appreciate what you have now. I mean, appreciate the guys like Andrew Ladd who are still going at his age when many thought he was never going to play hockey again.
Yeah.
Appreciate guys like Roussel and Beagle and Louis Erickson, you know, who are fighting for their jobs, still trying to prove they can still play the sport. And, you know, appreciate the young guys. I mean, you never know who's going to be your quote-unquote next Garland. I mean, Connor Garland was a, what, fifth, sixth-round pick, spent the majority of his career in the AHL, came up to Arizona, and it just came out of nowhere onto the scene. Appreciate those kind of guys. You never know who's going to get a call up from Tucson to Arizona and is going to be that next it guy for us. So appreciate what you have now. You know, the losses aren't fun, but appreciate that this team is coming out here every night trying to win. They're not trying to come out here and give you all a miserable experience. They're trying to come out there and win games for y'all.
Absolutely. So just
take that into effect. In the day, these guys are hardworking athletes who work nonstop around the clock. They are not trying to send y'all home unhappy. They're trying to play their butts off. I mean, they're trying to play their butts off.
Yep. And Connor Garland, honestly, I was probably the most upset to see him go in the scorched earth rebuild. That was a tough loss. Obviously, OEL is up there, but we kind of knew the writing had been on the wall with Ekman-Larsson for really a couple of years almost, that he was probably going to be moved at some point. So good stuff. And yeah, if I could add anything to all of that in terms of what do fans do to stay engaged, I'm going to say, there's this guy named Dylan Gunther playing up there in Edmonton right now. He's playing with the Oil Kings. And if nothing else, y'all should check out some Edmonton Oil Kings hockey.
Or Arizona State hockey. Check out Josh Stone. He's one of the lead leaders right now in assists, I'm pretty sure, in the NCAA. So check out him as well.
Donors tearing it up right down here in Tempe. Give me an opportunity for a shameless plug. The Hockey News Prospects Unlimited dropping in the U.S. on November 30th, and I've got an article on Donor in there. So check it out. Newsstands, November 30th, the Hockey News Prospects Unlimited. Well done, Haynes. but yeah, that's the point, right? Follow your prospects. Get excited about how well your prospects are playing, because it's amazing when you get ingrained in the minors and the farm systems, whether they're playing in the SHL overseas or the WHL, OHL, AHL, whatever. Follow them. It's fun. And this Gunther kid, man, he can play. He's a lot of fun to watch. So,
and if I can add something real quick to that,
us home.
Our last year of podcasts, we just celebrated our 1 year over at the Hockey Writers Grind Line. So Pat, congratulations. You've been there from the start. And you know, we spent most of last year talking about the cider hype train and the Raymond hype train and what that's going to mean. And so like we spent all last year, and then now we're reaping those rewards this year by how much excitement we put out there in the universe. And now it's paying off. So if nothing else, when you're going through a rebuild, find those little things that you enjoy about the team and then just support the hell out of them.
Yep. And speaking of prospects, we're going to get to our last segment of the night or the day, depending on when you're watching, I guess. And we've been making this a regular thing, and we're going to keep making this a regular thing, ladies and gentlemen. Tankathon 2021-22. What prospects should you be keeping your eye on that have a shot to go in as a lottery pick to the Coyotes? This week, we're going to focus on Matthew Savoy, 5'9", 179-pound center, considered by many, many, many to be a lottery pick, unanimously in the top 10 for sure. Highly skilled prospect, projected to be a future first liner. He's got quick hands. He's a very agile skater. And he's funny. You were talking about this before, Kyle. He's very, very competitive. It was actually kind of funny when I was doing some research on him. Almost every scouting report mentioned his competitiveness, which I thought was super cool. So Kyle, we'll start with you. Actually, no, Haynes, we're going to start with you, because I don't think I've started with you in a while. Your thoughts on Matthew Savoy if the Coyotes were to draft him?
You know, first off, I want to say we've hit on this on the show. I know that Matthew's hit on when he's come on. If the Coyotes don't get Shane Wright, it's not an end-of-the-world draft. Yeah. There's a lot of guys in the top 10 that are just as good, and Matthew Savoy is one of them. I mean, this kid is playing down in the WHL with the Winnipeg Ice. He's playing with a teammate. I'm pretty sure Connor Geeky's on his team with them. And the two of those guys easily could be top 10 picks easily together. And, I mean, he's exactly like you said. From what I've seen from watching him play-wise, this kid is very competitive. He plays a full 200-foot game back and forth down the ice. Always competitive. He's never giving up on the play. He's got great skills. He's a smart playmaker. if we landed him today, I would be just as happy as landing Shane Wright. I think that he's just as big of a difference maker as Shane Wright is, and I think he easily would be a great addition to Arizona as well.
Super good insight. Kyle, bring us home. You got the last word on this. Matthew Savoy, what would the Coyotes be getting if they draft him?
I just want to say first that I love this segment because I usually wait until it's like way late in the year toward till I start looking at the prospects. And so to really get a jump on it was kind of fun and do this research. But one thing that kind of stood out to me, and yeah, everyone's saying Shane Wright is the next NHL ready center in this draft. He's a fairly big bodied center, and he can kind of jump into that role almost immediately. I don't see that happening for Savoy in terms of jumping right into the NHL immediately as a center. However, he does remind me of another winger, and it's someone we've talked about already, and that's Lucas Raymond. He has a lot of the same skills as I was watching through his highlights today, preparing for the show. And a lot of what I saw just kind of reminded me of what we were seeing in Lucas Raymond's highlights heading into his draft year. He's about the same size. He plays a very similar style of game, and I thought he's got that NHL caliber shot and speed, and he uses his body really well. His body positioning is amazing. His strength is really good for a 17-year-old. He's able to body out people on a wide lane rush, and I just think he's one of those players that's creative enough that he's going to be a very good playmaker, if not goal scorer, in the NHL.
Love it. Absolutely fantastic insight. I have nothing intelligent to add. I know, shocker. But I kind of prepped it. I think you guys, your analysis is perfect and couldn't agree more. Look, if Shane Wright doesn't happen, if they don't get the number one overall pick, Matthew Savoy is certainly, if you could call him a consolation prize, certainly an outstanding consolation prize, and will be a lot of fun to watch develop no matter who is lucky enough to be able to draft him this year. So that is our show. First of all, Kyle, cannot thank you enough for sacrificing some time this evening to join us. Really appreciate it. And selfishly, it was a lot of fun to have you on.
Thank you so much. I just want to say, I think I survived the show without putting anything in the Phoenix jar. So, tell your wife, I am sorry.
The Tucson jar.
But I survived the Phoenix jar. That was my biggest my big hurdle coming into tonight. So
good stuff, Haynes. Pleasure as always. Do not forget at home. Thanks for watching. Like, subscribe, comment, follow us on Twitter at HowlersTHW. Follow Kyle on Twitter at THW_Knopp. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next time. Cheers.